Lucy Willow by Sally Gardner. Read by Dexter Fletcher. Chapter 1. Three Things About Lucy Willow. There were three things that marked out Lucy Willow as different from other children. The first was that she lived on a train. The second, just as important, was that she had a snail called Ernest as a pet. And the third, the most important of all, was that she had green fingers. That means that she had a gift for growing things, though at the time this story begins, she didn't know it. The Willow family hadn't always lived on a train. When Lucy was younger, they'd lived in London on the 17th floor of a high-rise block of flats. Dad didn't like heights. They made him feel sick. Mum, too, felt a little queasy and just wanted a place of their own in the country. This was no good for Dad, who worked in the city. They couldn't agree what to do for the best, though they both knew that something had to be done. Mum dreamed of having a garden for vegetables and flowers. Up there in the clouds was no place for plants. Every month she would buy magazines full of pictures of country cottages lovingly restored. Ah, Mum would sigh, that's my kind of house. If you'd asked Dad what kind of house he dreamed of, without a doubt he would have said an old railway station, a converted signal box maybe, for his passion was trains. His favourites were old steam trains. To him, they were as wonderful as dragons. He loved the noise they made and the way they blew steam out of their funnels, their colours, their names and their numbers. Oh, I think it might be better to stop there. Once you got Mr. Willow onto the subject of steam trains, there was no knowing where it would end. But what about Lucy Willow, with her chocolate brown eyes and her pretty dimples that showed every time she smiled? Where did she want to live? Why, that was easy. She didn't mind as long as they were all happy. She did have responsibilities, though. She had her pet snail, Ernest, whom she kept in a shoebox and who went everywhere with her. Lucy thought a bit of greenery would be good for his constitution.
Snails, said Lucy, like being on the ground, near nature. They aren't made for living on the 17th floor with the pigeons.
As it turned out, it was Dad's love of trains that would hold the answer to all their problems. One Saturday morning, while flicking through his train magazines, he saw an advertisement. It said simply, "A home for sale. Three bedrooms, bathroom, kitchen dining room, and must-see sitting room."
"Why," said Mum, "it's just what we need."
"It's a bing-bang bargain," said Dad.
"Well then," said Mum, "what are we waiting for?"
"There is just one small thing," said Dad.
"What's that?" asked Mum.
"The house is made up from three carriages."
"I can deal with that," said Mum.
"There is just one other teeny weeny hitch," said Dad.
"What's that?" asked Mum.
"The carriages are still attached to the train."
"Oh," said Mum.
"But the good thing about it," said Dad, "is that the train goes backwards and forwards between Liverpool Street Station and Malden in the Marsh."
"Where's that?" asked Mum.
Dad smiled. This was his trump card. "A pretty country village."
"All right," said Mum, still a little unsure. "Why does it go there?"
"Ah," said Dad with pride, "because this is the last steam train to run to any village. A Mr. Opal owns the train. He's something in confectionery. Anyway, to cut a long story short, his old mum lives in Malden in the Marsh, and she has never been too keen on all these newfangled trains, like Steam Best. A lady after my own heart."
Mum gave Dad's suggestion some thought. Then she said,
"Well, you work in the city, and we have always wanted to live in the country, and this, I suppose, is the best of both worlds. After all, beggars can't be choosers."
You have to take your hat off to Mum. She was always good at looking on the bright side. That settled it. They said goodbye to the flat and moved into their new home.
Ever since then, they've been shunted up and down from London to the country and back again Mondays to Saturdays every week. Well, maybe a little less when you take into account holidays, snow, leaves on the line, and once even the great excitement of a fallen tree. Chapter 2. The Train. It was an unusual place to live. The three carriages that made up their home had been sold with fixtures and fittings, which looked faded and very grand. The first carriage had been made into a kitchen. Mum hung pretty curtains at the windows and kept her pans in the luggage rack. The second carriage had a corridor running all along the carriage with rooms off to one side. There were two bedrooms and a bathroom, each with its own sliding door. The third carriage was divided up into a master bedroom and next to that a grand sitting room with a real wow factor to it. It was this carriage that had won Mum over to the idea of living on a train. There were gilded mirrors and a real chandelier that jingled and jangled as the train clickety-clacked along, and a button velvet sofa that felt prickly on the bottom when you sat down, as if it had been stuffed with the wrong end of the feathers. At the end of the room, there were doors with pattern-frosted glass that opened onto a balcony, where on fine days the willows would sit, watching where they had just come from disappear into the distance. There was much that Lucy liked about living on the train. On winter evenings, she loved looking out of her bedroom window at all the people huddled on the platforms waiting for their trains, fed up with journeys, dreaming of home, while she lay snug as a bug in a rug, in her nice warm bed, enjoying being rocked to sleep by the movement of the train. It made her feel safe to think that the driver and the guard were awake and working while she was in the land of dreams. The only drawback to being attached to the train that went between Liverpool Street Station and Malden-in-the-Marsh was that their lives were run by train timetables. And as we all know, timetables are a law unto themselves. It was the train timetables that decided where Lucy went to school. There was no choice. The train arrived at Liverpool Street at 6:16 in the morning, just in time for Dad to get to his office in the city. Then it shunted off again towards Malden-in-the-Marsh, arriving there at 8:24, just in time for Lucy to walk to the village school. At 4:30, the train doors would shut and the train huffed and puffed its way out of the station back towards Liverpool Street. Dad would join the train at 6:29 after finishing work in time for Lucy's tea, bath and bedtime. Then at 8:30 on the dot, the whistle would blow once again and the train would steam out of Liverpool Street, stopping at all the small, forgotten stations, delivering the mail up and down the line throughout the night and arriving back at Liverpool Street just in time for Dad to go to work. So, you can see that trains and timetables ruled the Willows' lives, and Lucy was sure that this was the way their world would spin forever. Then, suddenly, and for no good reason Lucy could think of, her mum and dad announced, as if it was the best news ever, that Lucy was going to have a baby brother or sister.
"Isn't it wonderful?" said Dad, looking as chuffed as if he'd just won the lottery.
"Well, no, not really," said Lucy. "Why would I want a brother or sister, for pity's sake, when I'm practically all grown up?"
Mum said kindly that she would get used to the idea and in the end be as pleased as they were, which Lucy knew was just plain silly.
"What is wrong with grown-ups?" she thought miserably. "Why do they never listen?"
Mum went into labour in the middle of the night. The driver shunted the train backwards as far as it could go so that she could get to the maternity hospital. And would you believe it? They didn't make it on time. Typical. Zack was born on the train while Lucy was asleep. They could at least have woken her. The baby confirmed what Lucy already knew, which was that babies were very overrated. And if Stench, as she called him, was anything to go by, a complete waste of time.
"How old does my baby brother have to be before he can play with me?" she asked. And on being told, she said grumpily, "Why did you bother?"
Babies, unlike trains, don't run to timetables, and Mum got all flustered and stressed, especially after Dad said that he could not take time off from his job. There was a crisis in the office and all the staff were expected to work round the clock to save the business. Mum was left trying to sort out the baby and the shopping, keep the train tidy and cook meals. There was so much washing that needed to be done that buckets with Stench's smelly clothes were forever being forgotten, only to fall over when the train began to move. It was enough to put a girl off her cornflakes. Dad was hardly ever there these days. The train just clickety-clacked back and forth without him, to the sound of Stench's crying. No, things were not going well. Then, one Wednesday, a day that always makes you think the weekend is too far away for its own good, Lucy got home from school to find Dad sitting at the kitchen table in his suit, his tie undone, looking pale and worried.
"You shouldn't be here," said Lucy, giving him a big hug. "We don't pick you up until 6:29.
He nodded sadly. "Yeah, I know," he said. "That's how things used to run."
"Is everything all right?"
asked Lucy. She looked around the kitchen, pleased to see that Stench was fast asleep in his cot. "I've been made redundant," said Dad.
"What does that mean?"
asked Lucy. "It means that I've lost my job," replied Dad.
"Oh, George," said Mum. "I'm sure something will turn up."
Chapter 3. The End of the Line.
"All change!"
was the name Lucy had given Malden in the marsh. She would hear the station master shout it out every time they arrived.
"This train," he would bellow, "has reached the end of the line. All change!"
As the weeks went by, and Dad hadn't found another job, those words began to have a worrying ring. "How are we going to pay the mortgage?" asked Dad. "My savings are nearly spent and the bank won't lend us another penny."
"That's ridiculous," said Mum.
"Train carriages are not what they call a sound investment," said Dad gloomily. Lucy heard these alarming conversations as she lay in bed thinking and wondering what on earth would happen next. What happened next began on the day Stench's first tooth appeared, and he was screaming at full blast. A brown envelope came through their letterbox. It said that Mr. Opal was sorry to report that his mother had passed away, and there was no more need for him to keep the train running. Therefore, he had sold the line and the stock to Bridgemount Railway Company. He hoped they would keep things just the way they were. The next day, a notice was stuck to the door of the front carriage. It said that Bridgemount Railway Company had been taken over by a Texan billionaire, a Mr. Buzz Logan, who had plans to develop the line. It went on to say that the company was committed to the safety of the general public and was not a housing association. A telephone helpline number followed.
"What does that mean?"
asked Mum above the noise of Stench's crying.
"I wish I knew," said Dad.
He spent the rest of the day on the phone trying to get through to someone. Finally, he spoke to a very nice gentleman in Delhi who said he was very sorry, but he could not help. He suggested writing or emailing the new owner.
"What are we going to do, George?"
asked Mum, looking tearful, which was very unlike her.
"I suppose someone will tell us what's going on," said Dad.
"Will we have to move?"
asked Lucy.
"I don't know. We own the carriages, but without somewhere for them to go, we are pretty stuck," said Dad.
"It's not looking good," said Lucy to Ernest, who for a snail was a very good listener.
"What happens if we're left in a siding near Liverpool Street Station? How would I get to school then?"
Ernest stuck out his long eyes and looked pretty shocked at the idea of being abandoned in a grubby old siding with not a plant in sight.
"I know," said Lucy. "Things are bad."
Ernest looked as if he might be saying,
"If only humans carried their homes on their backs like me,"
which Lucy thought was a bit irritating as they were all in this mess together, shell or no shell. A week later, a very smart man turned up at Liverpool Street Station. He knocked on their front door and introduced himself as Mr. Dallas. He said he was here on behalf of Mr. Buzz Logan. Mum and Dad took him into the kitchen. Mr. Dallas looked around.
"You have made a mighty fine home here, if I may say so, ma'am," he said in a long, drawn-out Texan accent.
"Thank you," said Mum. She made a pot of tea while Dad sat nibbling his nails in a nervous kind of way. Mr. Dallas took out a laptop from his briefcase.
It made a heavy bong as the screen flashed into life.
"Let's get straight to the point," said Mr. Dallas. "After all, time is money and money is time. The bottom line is this. You own these three carriages and we own the track."
"That's right," said Dad.
"We bought..." "The problem," interrupted Mr. Dallas sharply, "is that we don't want your carriages on our tracks anymore. Not the right image for the 21st century. You get my point."
"But you can't do that. It's the oldest steam train in the country and the only one that's still running. It's historic," said Dad.
"It's history," said Mr. Dallas firmly.
"We are looking towards the future, not the past. That was yesterday. We are about tomorrow."
"So what are we supposed to do today?"
asked Mum.
"Find yourself some land that you can put your carriages on," said Mr. Dallas.
"But," said Dad, "that will cost a fortune, and we don't have a fortune."
"Butts are for babies, Mr. Willow,"
snapped Mr. Dallas. Right on cue, Stench started to scream. You could see that Mr. Dallas didn't like babies.
"Does that infant have a volume control?" he asked. "If it does, could you turn it down?"
"No, he doesn't," said Mum. "Please, can you tell us just what's going to happen?"
"A pleasure, ma'am," said Mr. Dallas, putting his laptop back into the briefcase. You could see that he was keen to be gone.
"Mr. Logan is a family man, and out of the kindness of his heart, he is going to give you 3 months to make alternative arrangements. For the time being, you will be shunted into a siding at Malden in the Marsh, and we will, for a small fee, supply you with water, electricity, and plumbing. Mr. Logan will charge you a rent for the site. When the 3 months are up, we will expect you to have the train moved from the siding."
"That will need a crane," said Dad. "Have you any idea how much that will cost?"
"In the thousands," said Mr. Dallas without the blink of an eye.
He handed them the breakdown of the rent for the 3 month period. Mum and Dad stared at the figures put in front of them.
"This is daylight robbery," said Dad.
"No," said Mr. Dallas. "This is Mr. Logan being generous. Take it or leave it."
Dad had no option. He took it.
"One last thing," said Mr. Dallas, snapping shut his briefcase. "If these carriages aren't gone in 3 months, we will have your home taken away for scrap."
"You can't do that," said Dad.
"With £1 billion in the bank, Mr. Logan can do what he damn well pleases," said Mr. Dallas as he left the train.
That evening, they shunted out of Liverpool Street Station for the last time. At Malden in the Marsh, the carriages were uncoupled from the train, and the Willow family watched sadly as it puffed and clickety-clacked its way back to London and retirement, without them.
"Well," said Mum, walking Stench up and down, "being still might do us a lot of good. The country air will help Zach sleep."
"I can't believe they've done this," said Dad.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.